Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. I will try not to shout. I have a very loud voice, so if I am overstimulating anyone, let me know. All right. I am Arti Rai, a professor at Duke Law School, and I'm delighted to welcome all of you to this conference on the very important issue of how to improve access to life-saving therapies and diagnostics, particularly in the developing world, where, as you know, millions die every year for a lack of such access. I'm also delighted to welcome you to Duke. What you may not know, at least some of you may not know, is that Duke has really been at the forefront of activities in the global health arena. And I will beg your indulgence for just a few moments to tell you about all the wonderful things that Duke has been doing before I get to the specific topics of our conference. Just quite recently, under the leadership of our new president, President Richard Broadhead, we have announced a global health initiative. And this global health initiative is still in its incipient phases, but there's a steering committee that has been set up to come up with specific tasks that might be undertaken under the guise of this initiative. And the co-chair of that steering committee, Bob Cook-Deegan, our own Bob Cook-Deegan is in the audience here, so if you have questions about that initiative, Bob, could you raise? Yeah. he will no doubt know everything there is to know. Bob is, in addition to being the co-chair of the steering committee, he's also, believe it or not, the head of the Center for the Study of Public Genomics here, which also looks into some global health issues, and the Genome Ethics Law and Policy Center, so he wears many hats. The medical school has recently announced the creation of the Hubert Jurgen Center for Global Health, dedicated to these issues. So even before the steering committee comes up with its recommendations, we have already begun to do various things in this arena. The Sanford Institute of Public Policy and the Program on Global Health and Technology Access, which our own Anthony So, who's sitting inconspicuously in the back, heads up, has just enrolled its first class of 14 Global Health Fellows. And these Global Health Fellows include Fulbright Fellows, Gates Cambridge Fellows, former Peace Corps workers and graduate students in medical public policy and public health schools from all over the country, and they will spend their summer in Geneva addressing global health policy issues. A team of us here at Duke, Anthony, myself, Bob Cook-Deegan, are in the process of responding to a request from the World Health Organization to write a report on the role that the public sector can do in facilitating technology transfer that will promote access to for developing countries in the healthcare arena. And then finally, a group of students here is organizing a global health forum to give an umbrella to various groups that are organizing around issues of global health at Duke. So a lot of stuff is going on here, in short, and we're delighted that we can put on this conference, which squarely places itself in the midst of all these exciting activities that are going on. Now, many of you are well aware that intellectual property rights on drugs can have, don't necessarily have, but can have a negative impact on access in the developing world. And figuring out how to deal with the issue of intellectual property rights on end product drugs is hard enough, as we've seen through some of the well-publicized disputes over access to antiretroviral AIDS drugs in sub-Saharan Africa. It's important to recognize, though, that intellectual property rights can block access not only when they cover the end product drug, but also when they cover research inputs such as cell lines, reagents, antigens, target proteins, and the like, that are necessary for doing research in a particular area of disease that affects the developing world. And while it might be possible for drug developers who work on diseases with large, rich country markets to expend the resources necessary for negotiating through various intellectual property thickets, the millions of dollars necessary to negotiate through these thickets, and there's evidence that they do spend these millions of dollars because the payoff is in the billions of dollars. Obviously, that's a lot harder to do when the resources available to do research on a disease, because the market payoff is going to be small, are extremely limited. However, there is light in this, what might otherwise seem to be a rather bleak picture. As we well know, public funding is often responsible for the relevant research. So public sector and nonprofit institutions, including academic institutions, can have a real impact on how intellectual property rights are deployed. And that is the focus of our conference. We bring together, I think, a remarkable array of talent to address how collective action by public sector institutions could help address intellectual property issues. And in particular, this morning, we'll have two panels, one focusing on collective action through licensing possibilities, and the other on collective action through patent pooling of various sorts. Roughly speaking, I think we can divide the two panels in the following way conceptually. The first panel will deal with innovative mechanisms for preventing intellectual property roadblocks from arising in the first instance. And the second panel will focus on similarly innovative mechanisms for dealing with existing intellectual property issues, particularly on research inputs. I will be moderating the first panel, and my colleague and co-organizer, Anthony So, who we've already met as the director of the Program on Global Health and Technology Access at the Sanford School of Public Policy, will be moderating the second panel on pooling. So before I introduce the first panel, let me take a brief moment to thank the sponsors of this event. We've been very fortunate in having many patrons. These include the Rockefeller Foundation. Jake Wertzman from the Rockefeller Foundation is here. The World Health Organization, as I've mentioned, they've commissioned this report, and we're hoping that the discussions in this conference will deepen and enrich a draft of this report that we have currently in very, very preliminary draft form, and will be available later on to participants. Duke Law School's own Center for the Study of the Public Domain, headed up by our inestimable Jamie Boyle, who is here as well. And the Duke Center for the Study of Public Genomics, also headed up by Bob Cook Deegan, as I've mentioned, through indirectly, at least, the generosity also of the National Institutes of Health and the Department of Energy that have given the enabling grant for the Center for the Study of Public Genomics. And NIH is well represented here through the Director of the Office of Technology Transfer, Mark Rohrbaugh, and Steve Ferguson, who is on our panel. So without further ado, then, let me introduce this panel, which is just a remarkable array of talent. I'm so delighted that all of these folks could come here today. And in order to facilitate the progress of the presentations, and so I won't be intruding upon what I think will be just some very exciting presentations, I will introduce all four of our panelists at the beginning. And what I will do then in between panelists is just give a one-line introduction as to what they're going to speak about. What I'd like to do, if possible, is simply have clarifying questions after each panelist's presentation, and that will leave us a large amount of time for a very vibrant discussion at the end that will allow us to synthesize all of the presentations. If that is acceptable, I will go ahead and go start introducing our panelists. First, we have Amy Kapczynski, who is a fellow at the Yale Law School and the Yale School of Public Health, and is just at her, in her early stage of her career, has done remarkable things already in the area of global health. She's a graduate of Princeton University and a fairly recent graduate of Yale Law School, but already she has, I think, been one of the key players in changing our thinking about how intellectual property rights owned by the public sector can can work in improving access to global health. She was instrumental in raising the issue of university licensing at Yale over D4T, which is an important drug for the treatment of HIV/AIDS. And she is one of the co-founders of Universities Allied for Essential Medicines, which is a very important coalition that has come up with some very interesting licensing models that could improve access in developing countries. She clerked for the Second Circuit and prior to her current position as a fellow in law and public health. Yochai Benkler, who will be our second speaker, is a law professor at Yale Law School. He is a real thought leader in the area of information flow. And when I say information flow, I mean information flow in all areas, whether it be his current interest, which is the biomedical arena, or spectrum policy, telecommunications more generally, intellectual property more generally, relevant aspects of US constitutional law. He is truly, I think, one of the leading scholars of his generation in thinking very broadly and widely about information flows and intellectual property impacts on information flows. Steve Ferguson, our third speaker, currently serves in the NIH Office of Technology Transfer as the director of a 50-member division of technology development and transfer, which is the patenting and licensing group for NIH and FDA technologies. Prior to joining NIH, where he's been since 1990, Mr. Ferguson served in various senior marketing and management positions in various biomedical firms. He is a registered patent agent, holds master's degrees in business administration and chemistry, as well as a bachelor's degree in chemistry. He is a visiting lecturer, has been a visiting lecturer at the Watson School of Biological Sciences at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory, and has published numerous articles on licensing and tech transfer issues. And then finally, Katherine Wu, our last speaker today, is the director of scientific affairs at a wonderful public-private partnership known as the Institute for One World Health. It's the first nonprofit pharmaceutical company in the United States. She joined One World Health in 2003. She is involved in creating product development partnerships with pharmaceutical and biotech companies, academic centers, and other nonprofit groups. She received her PhD from California Institute of Technology and Master's of Engineering and Bachelor's degrees from Cornell University. So without further ado, let me let Amy begin her presentation. Amy will be talking about a very interesting model that she and Yochai have been working on, known as the Equitable Access License, that I think is one of the most creative mechanisms for thinking about how universities can license in a manner that improves access for the developing world.
Thanks to Arti and all the organizers of this conference. It's an incredible group of people on a topic that's very close to my heart and my intellectual interest, so I'm very excited to see what happens over the next day and a half. I'm going to do a somewhat general presentation to try to set the stage of the context for the licensing models, actually, that Yochai is going to then talk about in more detail. So I'm going to set the context and the kind of political economy of the situation, and then Yochai will talk more specifically about the model. Do I have control over this?
Yes, you do. Yes.
Okay, that's good.
Forwards and backwards.
Okay. So as Arti mentioned, every year, millions of people in low and middle income countries die because they die of preventable and treatable diseases. So this is the first slide, very low tech, but comparative life expectancy, something that I think is never sort of fails to amaze me. So in richer countries, life expectancy going up, in poorer countries, life expectancy going down, so that the gap now, the latest data in Japan, if you're born today, you can expect over 80 years of life. In a country like Botswana or Sierra Leone, about half or less than half of that. Obviously, a lot of this has to do with HIV/AIDS. And this is a specific slide about the impact of AIDS on life expectancy in some of the most heavily affected countries. In 2000, the average worldwide price for patented... the average price for patented antiretroviral medications was about over $10,000. And today, that medicine, the same medicine for the basic first-line therapy, which is not our only problem, but is about $150 a year. So this dramatic reduction price has enabled governments and international agencies to initiate programs to bring medicines to the people who need them. There are still big problems with those programs, but they're being initiated now, in part because of this reduction in price. And there's another picture, which you were going to see. In case you've never seen what antiretrovirals do to someone, this is what they do, sort of before and after picture of a young Haitian man. It's very compelling. So you'll just have to imagine it in your head. You've probably all seen them before.
Get your Mac and plug it in. We can make it work if you've got your thing with it. I mean, I know that's what the cause is, right? You did this. This is a PowerPoint.
Yeah, I did it on Mac.
And they're running on a Windows. You can hook up your computer.
I have my
computer
here.
Make it work.
Yeah.
Make it work.
Yeah.
Sorry, they should have said.
Technology transfer issue.
The whole proprietary rights thing, but it doesn't cause any inefficiency.
It'll come down.
Yeah.
It's another IP problem.
Yeah, exactly. Lack of connectivity.
So that's the question is this would this be a commercial for Apple or not?
We
weren't expecting Apple. I'm not sure we could.
It may not happen with the rest of them. I don't know.
That won't work. Oh, okay.
Yeah, the rest of them are fine, I think. No. Yeah, so we can just carry on.
Yeah.
Unless you really want to see what somebody with ARVs, taking ARVs.
Let's go on, and then we can come back.
We need to do it.
All right. So the price reductions in ARVs has really driven a lot of this interest in the contribution that patents make today and will make in the future to these inequities in life expectancy around the world. And part of the reason for this controversy is that over the roughly past two decades, we've witnessed a steady trend towards more restrictive patent and exclusive rights, both in countries like the United States and internationally. So in the United States, patents have moved further upstream in the biomedical research process, increasingly been supplemented with exclusivity offered at the drug regulatory interface. Over the same period, the United States, with the help of the European Union and Japan, has pushed high levels of substantive and procedural protection for intellectual property rights on countries around the world through international agreements, like the main agreement in this context is the World Trade Organization's TRIPS agreement. That's the foundation of this treaty architecture. But regional and bilateral agreements are now increasingly supplementing the protection, the sort of basic level of protection that's required within TRIPS. Proponents of this intellectual property expansion contend that it will spur innovation and therefore increase aggregate social welfare. This is the dominant justification for patents and intellectual property today. But economists are ambivalent about this claim. So this probably will not surprise anyone in this room, but information is non-rival. That means my having access to your knowledge doesn't mean that you have less of it. So if you invent a scientific formula, I can access it without diminishing your ability to access it. Because it's non-rival, it can be distributed most efficiently at a marginal cost of zero. But at that cost, there would be disincentives to create it, since you couldn't recoup your investment. Patents are one answer to this problem, but because information is an input as well as an output of the innovation process, as Arti was mentioning, having too strong exclusive rights will negatively impact on innovation. Obviously, exclusive rights also negatively impact on access because they raise prices and create deadweight losses. So whether or not patents are an optimal strategy to promote innovation in wealthy markets, economists have long recognized that the static costs to a country that newly adopts patents, a country, for example, like India, where a lot of this work has been done, in a world where there already are patents, in a multi-country world, the costs are likely to be even higher for a country like India, and the benefits proportionally smaller. So perversely, patients in poor countries are likely to suffer more from patents and benefit less. They suffer more because they're very sensitive to price, often not insulated by governments or by private insurance companies from the cost of medicines, and therefore the cost, even small increases in cost, can have very large impacts on people's health. They benefit less. So the dynamic benefits in terms of innovation are likely to be much smaller than if you just thought about this in a hypothetical one-country world, particularly if the new markets are small compared to the old markets, and that's the case. So I think this slide will work.
Yeah.
Sorry. So this is a picture of the projected market for global pharmaceuticals in 2002. You can see that 80% of the worldwide market is in the United States, Europe, and Japan. If you look at pharma data, specifically the data from the trade industry, the lobbying industry that's comprised, lobbying agency that's comprised of the R&D-based pharmaceutical industry in this country, you'd see it's even less, about 5% of your of their income comes from low- and middle-income countries. So at the same time that countries are being pushed to adopt strong patent rights, it's become clear that the global drug distribution system isn't meeting their needs. This realization is what's known as the 1090 gap. Again, sort of stunning fact that only 10% of the world's expenditure on R&D is devoted to conditions that cause 90% of the global disease burden. So, for example, we haven't had a new TB drug in 20 years. So this R&D gap is the most common way to understand the dynamic failures of patents for people living in low- and middle-income countries. Simply put, patents don't help the poorest of the poor, because a monopoly on them is not worth very much. But as noted by Arti, patents can also be a drag on the innovation process itself, and that's also an important issue, particularly where research is of low commercial value. So what do we do about this? Obviously, and I think I don't need to tell any of you this, patents and prices are not the only issue ever in terms of access to medicines, but they can raise prices, and where they do that, that can have very devastating effects, and the R&D gap is obviously a major problem for the vast inequalities in life expectancy that we saw earlier. So most of the proposals that exist and that have been sort of made recently have been top-down proposals, proposing changes at the statutory level or at the international sort of treaty level, changes to TRIPS or price controls. And the kind of most prominent proposals in this regard have been trying to get countries to use flexibilities that they retain under these trade agreements and on a countrywide level to override patents through compulsory licenses, for example, and allow generic medicines to enter the market. On the R&D side, same thing, lots of proposals, some of them coming from people here at Duke, to reform the Bayh-Dole Act, to create statutory research exemptions, lots of these same sort of top-down initiatives that you see. This problem with any strategy that relies on government action, particularly when we're talking about developing countries, there are really two problems. One is just this unfortunate reality that where the beneficiaries of the temporary monopolies that patents provide, they can and will spend up to the value of these monopoly rents in order to prevent legislation that threatens their ability to extract these rents. It's a very profitable industry, and there's a lot of money going into ensuring that the system stays the way it is. So a lot of these proposals, while they may be perfectly legitimate and compelling at the empirical level, have had very little political success. So one problem is this influence of industries on governments. So at the international stage particularly, governments like the United States remain deeply committed to this agenda of ratcheting up intellectual property rights and decreasing the freedoms that countries have to address this problem on their own through free trade agreements, especially now, as opposed to the WTO, where some U.S. has been slightly less successful recently. But just as importantly, any kind of top-down strategy relies on the ability of countries and the willingness of countries at the local level, low- and middle-income countries, to address this problem on their own, and that willingness has been very variable. There are high kind of administrative costs of trying to do this, and countries that don't have a lot of resources, just trying to follow the procedures that are associated with compulsory licensing can be sort of onerous. Countries don't necessarily care about poor patients in their own within their own borders. So in part because of, and they don't necessarily commit their own money to R&D, right? But in part because of this, there's a third category, and this is the category that Yochai and I are really interested of a category of proposals that have come up that are not, they're not either, sorry, missed the second category. So the first category is this top-down strategy. Second category is sort of voluntary price reductions and like sort of charitable initiatives to do donations and things like that. The main problem with those has been that they've not generally been very quick. They're not very widespread. They don't necessarily cover, for example, the private market where lots of people get their health care. And the power balance has always been remained the same, so that companies tend to give sort of discounts and things when they see that it's necessary and not necessarily in a comprehensive way. There's a third category of initiatives, which are commons-based proposals and projects. These rely not on government action or on private sector price-driven market-mediated solutions, but on forms of production coordination that don't use exclusive rights. They use exclusive rights, but in order to ensure that people are included rather than excluded from end products, for example, or research. And they rely on mechanisms other than price signals to coordinate behavior. And without waiting for governments to act, we're seeing these kinds of solutions arising. We're seeing them more and more in the biomedical domain, and they're adapting contractual terms, and I think Yochai will talk a little bit about this, from open source software, from lots of other areas of innovation, that use and do this, they sort of turn intellectual property on its head and assert rights of, for example, as open source software does, of users to modify and then put back into the public domain or into these same kind of licensing arrangements their own their own innovations. So here's some of these sort of disparate individual initiatives that are going on. That we're trying to think about and gather into and sort of consolidate into some collective approach. The first is the Yale D4T agreement, as we saw, as Arti mentioned, I was involved in this when I was at Yale. By agreeing not to enforce its patent and encouraging the BMS, which is the company that Yale had exclusively licensed the drug to reduce its prices, within a matter of weeks, Yale reduced the price of this drug by about 95% in South Africa and got price reductions for all over the country. And this is now being taken up, these sorts of initiatives, by other universities and other public sector institutions. So all realizing that if you do try to adopt proactively proposals in your licensing agreements rather than react after a problem arises, you have potentially more power. And Berkeley recently signed an agreement with the government of Samoa about a drug that may turn into an AIDS drug, and within that promised to have reasonable pricing arrangements with any eventual licensee. The NIH, and I hope maybe we'll hear more about this from Steve Ferguson, now says that they require marketing plans when they license to pharma companies about what they're going to do about marketing to reach consumers in developing countries. So these are the kinds of initiatives that we're interested in. The R&D gap, we're starting to see lots of patent gifts to these public-private partnerships, initiatives, nonprofit drug development initiatives, such as One World Health. So lots of universities have been involved in these sorts of initiatives. In the agricultural domain, PIPRA is trying to do, I think most of you are familiar with that, but trying to develop similarly some licensing-based strategies to reserve research rights and ensure access to end products in developing countries in the agriculture domain. Universities are getting more sophisticated about adopting specific research exemptions in their licenses to try to avoid some of these thicket, sort of anti-commons problems, reserving research rights for themselves and potentially other universities when they license things out. And there are two sort of interesting models in this regard that I've come across. Be interested to hear if other people know of more. One is the clause at Stanford that requires, in any exclusive license, they say, we have the right and any other university has the right to do research, including sponsored research. We will not be excluded from research. Another is the Wisconsin Alumni Research Foundation, which manages University of Wisconsin's intellectual property. University of Wisconsin is the holder of many important stem cell patents. And Wharf's standard license doesn't allow sponsored research, but it does take back any improvements that innovators make to their technologies. So says, if you make an improvement, we get it back for our own research purposes, and we can sublicense that to other institutions, other universities and nonprofit government agencies. And the NIH is now doing some very interesting work licensing directly to developing country R&D organizations, sometimes limited exclusivity, sometimes non-exclusive, in order to develop drugs for neglected diseases, but also in areas of cancer and so on. So looking at this, again, with this political economy and the problems with top-down solutions in mind, universities look like a pretty good place to start trying to change some of these practices. Universities are responsible for more than half of the country's basic research science. They're essential to the drug development system. So four AIDS drugs came out of universities, including one here at Duke. Cancer drugs as well, the best-selling glaucoma medication in the country. Universities actually have intellectual property rights in a number of medicines. But as you go further upstream in the research process, they have even more rights. Their share is disproportionately at the higher, you know, sort of upstream in the research process. Universities are also increasingly asserting patents and intellectual property rights in the technologies that they develop. So another reason that universities are a good place to try to address this problem is that their core institutional principles include the production and dissemination of knowledge, as well as in related to more general dedication to improving human welfare. So for much of the 20th century, academic institutions were committed to allowing their discoveries to freely enter the public domain. This is the sort of Mertonian tradition of open science, which has come under pressure recently, but provides a kind of cultural context for universities to think about the specific and special role that they play in this process. Official university patenting and licensing policies typically declare that the ultimate purpose is the promotion of the public good, and that's not, it's difficult to reconcile with any narrow focus on maximizing the number of patents or licensing and royalty revenues and things like that. Also, universities, as Yale's experience with staviding D4T shows, there can be intra-institutional tensions, which is sort of the fancy way of saying, you know, students can get very upset and faculty can get very upset because they see the university's mission as being distinct and something that they want to protect, and they can assert their own demands and interests in ensuring that access actually happens. Lastly, the number of schools that make money from technology transfer is small, and those that profit tend to do so from a limited number of highly successful patents. So I put some figures up there. And anyway, the financial cost of universities are likely to be small. Then add upon that how small the markets in developing countries are, and you see why this looks to be a promising place to make some more systemic change. So there is what I would say is latent potential in the public sector, and the question is how can that best be utilized? And that I leave to Yochai.
Clarifying questions after both of these. So if we have clarifying questions, Yochai is going to talk about nuts and bolts, or as he said, spanners and something else.
Some
and wrenches.
Some inappropriate analogy. You see now we're getting this Apple connection on both sides. Yes, I remember this one.
Yeah.
You can wheel the podium over also, if you'd like, so that it's
good.
Closer.
Perfect.
There. And here's your computer. I apologize.
Okay. One foot longer. Okay. How are we doing?
Arti is sitting. Yeah, maybe you can sit where I'm sitting. Yeah.
And then I would have to sit.
Well, you could stand and...
Does this offend you aesthetically? Does this offend anyone aesthetically? No, good. So, two facts that are important as baseline. One, some portion of many deaths is the consequence of the rent extraction portion of patent-based pricing. So some number of deaths out of, what is it today, the UN report on AIDS in Africa came out today, 6,500 people a day die because of the rent portion, 6,500 people a day die of AIDS in Africa now. We often hear, and Arti said this to begin with, that it's not all patents. Of course it's not all patents. Some portion has to do with the fact that patent pricing is as high, and as Amy mentioned, the price of the particular drug that was involved in the Yale BMS D4T dropped to 1/20th of what it was just a few months before. So some portion, 5%, 0.5%, however many you're talking about, you're still talking about thousands of people a week who need not die. If we did this one thing, which is squeeze out the rent portion of the price that's attributable to patent, which we put there on purpose because it provides incentives for creation. So the basic point is we need to get the deaths to incentives ratio right. We need to calibrate it well. And part of this effort is to calibrate it well to save some number of lives a day. The other point is that we used to think of solutions falling into one of two bins. There was the government and there was the market. There were market solutions, patents, etc., in all sorts of domains. And there were government solutions, government funding, subsidies, actual provisioning, the police. What we've seen across a wide range of domains that have to do with information production is, for a very long time, a very large portion to a third sector, if you will, the sector of not formally government, but also not market actors. And universities have been a central organization of information production along this dimension for centuries. But what we're seeing now, and software in software than anywhere else, is the emergence of many new interesting models of legal relations and organizational relations that actually produce goods that we used to think of as coming from the market, outside of the market, but not within government. So this is an effort to have universities do that. And here are a few facts that inform the structure of the transaction. First of all, universities rarely own all of the patents necessary to make an end product. That means that the basic response of, I'm not responsible, I don't patent in X country in Africa. Or here, I will do the good thing. Anyone can use my patents to produce for Africa, doesn't work. It makes you feel good, but it doesn't get the job done. You need to get the improvements and the developments created by whoever the licensee was to the point that it's an end product, together with the original university license. Second, this is a happenstance of the pharmaceutical industry. It's not true in all industries, but it's true here. There's a very serious generic sector that exists for places without patents. So we have this opportunity. If we find a way of creating freedom to operate, there's an industry waiting in the sidelines available to come in. This may or may not be true across all kinds of drugs, may not be true across all kinds of health-related products, but it's there. And if we find a strategy of releasing that industry from the constraints that patents purposefully put on their entry in order, remember, to generate the rents for incentives, then we don't need to produce. All we need to do is create the freedom to operate. And again, patent rents account for a large portion of the drugs. So if we get the generics producing at competitive rates without the rents, we can actually get drugs and save lives. Another set of core transactional facts, universities vary widely in the size of their tech transfer offices, their budgets, their competence. Universities also vary widely in the political makeup and will of the administrations, of the students, of the tech transfer offices, of the scientists. And universities vary widely in their bargaining power vis-a-vis licensees. All of these have a certain set of implications for the transaction that might be desired. You want a standard practice. You want a simple model that can be applied across universities, even the university that happens to have something that's very valuable, even though they don't have it a lot and they don't have the experience to do the licensing. It limits the efficacy of solutions on the model of the university will roll up its sleeves and monitor every licensee over time and make sure, here, let's negotiate this, let's negotiate that. Because for that, you need mobilization, you need competence, you need a large staff. And it also means we need to keep the university out of the role of the monitor, the litigator, the enforcer. So how do we set something up that is simple, that can be standardized, that leaves the university largely out of it, and that involves one exertion at the beginning, but not continuous monitoring? So that's for everything, including and primarily end products. For developing world diseases only, freedom to operate will not suffice. So there are questions of research and investing research. You're going to need funding. But there are problems that patents create as barriers. The same approach that we can think of to eliminate the barriers to production, we could use for research. So let me just take you through the transaction flow. The moment of exertion, there's a big moment of exertion politically where the universities decide to adopt something like this. But on an ongoing basis, per transaction, the moment of exertion is the initial moment of inserting an agreement into the standard licensing agreement that would set up a process whereby the university's role in continuing to monitor is minimized. But from that license, a set of rights flows eventually to the generics or to researchers on neglected diseases that would give them the freedom to operate each in their own domain. The basic model here is a particular adaptation of the underlying institutional innovation of open source software, which says you can have, our usual standard model of thinking of patents very often is, here, you can have my invention, give me money. In this case, it's here, you can have my invention, give me money and rights. Okay, it's the same model. It's fundamentally different from all of the efforts to change legislatively or through government policy. It doesn't need a change in law. It doesn't need to go through the politics of Congress. It doesn't need a change of any international treaty. Here, here's my patent, give me money, as opposed to here's my patent, give me money and rights. Very often we see in patents, here's my patent, give me yours. Right? That's a standard. So it's combining very standard moves into the model. So here's my patent. What you give me back is a set of rights specifically tailored to enable the following flow. So university at the end has this set of rights. The trigger is some notifier, right? The university doesn't have to come and say, oh, we can solve this problem here. Someone out there, it can be a generic manufacturer, it can be a Ministry of Health, it can be MSF, says, here's a problem here. I have the ability to deliver drugs here. I need this. Sends a notification to the university and the pharmaceutical. The result of that is that these rights that were negotiated to begin with, here's my rights, plus the things that you give me plus the things you give me for this purpose, come to you, the supply notifier. The notifier then gives back anything that the notifier themselves improved. So if they worked out a heat stable mechanism, if they work out a 3-in-1 combination, whatever the improvements flow back up to the university for the same purposes and back to the original pharmaceutical potentially. Now, one of the things that happens when you have compulsory license models or things like that is it might work for the country, for manufacture in the country that's under emergency, but that's not usually where the manufacturing competence is. But this is a private arrangement. You can ask in exchange for what you give anything you like. It's just a contract. So what you get is you can manufacture anywhere. You can manufacture in Canada, you can manufacture in India, you can manufacture in Brazil under this license, using not only the university rights, but the rights that were granted back in the context of the original agreement, as long as you distribute only in the end product related country. And we have some fairly, I mean, we need a mechanism to make sure that these things don't end up back in the developed world, but that's simple to do in the same way that one different packaging, whatever it is. There's arm waving that this is a problem, but I don't, unless we think that customs really is incapable of telling the difference between the blue pill and the red pill, that seems to be not as much of a problem. We try to do the same thing with research notification, which is to say, I'm a researcher, and I'll talk a little bit about under what circumstances we use this when I'm done with showing the flow. Same idea, and again, you can do research anywhere on neglected research, and you can, in our expansive and ideal model, distribute the outputs in low and middle income countries as well for research. But the basic structure, the thing that is that needs to be understood is general university practice, contractual in nature, here's my rights in exchange for a flow of rights that can then automatically be notified, and then action can happen everywhere. The university's role, mind you, in all of this, as you notice, is only in the original agreement. After that, for example, let's just say a generic manufacturer produces an end product in South Africa. Let's say the pharmaceutical firm has a patent in South Africa. The university is out of the argument. Pharma comes to South African court and says, patent violation. Generic comes and says, I've got a license. There may be litigation, but it's not with the university. So basically what you have to do is create a mechanism that is with a sufficient comfort level for the generics to enter. And all of the trigger and the enforcement comes from ANNAs among the market actors, with the universities acting as a point of extracting the rights and as a legal flow through. Let me just say a few words about research, and then from some of the raised eyebrows, I think clarification questions are what would be the most effective thing. For research, there are a number of toggles, and Amy mentioned WARF and some of the research exemption licensing that's going on now. So the first thing is there are toggles. You could capture only the university's own technology and say, we reserve this for research purposes. You could say in the model as we have it, the licensee's improvements. Here, you can use this research tool in exchange for any improvements, research tool type improvements, back to me. Or you could have the licensee's associated technologies that are independently useful. So here, you can use my research tools. In exchange, you give me not only my research tool back, your improvements to my research tool, but also any other research tools you have that are necessary for a particular, say, neglected disease. So these are three ways in increasing levels of aggressiveness, if you will, of what it is that you're asking for. For whom? You can say for me, for the university. You can say for me and other research institutes, or you could say for anyone notifying that you're doing neglected research. Applied to what? You can have a loose definition, diseases that primarily affect populations in developing nations. You can have a tight list. You could just say, for this list of diseases. Or you could say, more generally, which is, again, the expansive approach that we are taking as an ideal model, orphan diseases in this particular case. It involves a certain number of people less than a certain number of people in the US, that'll cover a lot. And in fact, it'll cover more than only things that are primarily developing world focused. And again, what can be done? One option is research only. The other is research and distribution in low and middle income countries. As you can see, each of these is a degree of freedom in designing the tool at the end of the day, ranging from a very moderate proposal to a fairly expansive proposal of how much freedom to research we can have.
Okay, well, I think that clarifying questions are in order for both Amy and Yochai. As Yochai's presentation indicated, this is a very interesting model, but in a 10-minute oral presentation, perhaps all the points don't get across. So, Jamie.
This is not perhaps entirely fair as a clarifying question because I've seen the larger model, but Yochai, maybe it would be useful if you expanded very briefly on the following points. First, you implied halfway through the presentation what these clauses were limited to, low and middle income countries, but you didn't stress the definition or how that would apply. I think that would help people. Second, why would companies buy this? Maybe you could wrap in Amy's points about the percentages of profits that are actually bought, public interest, public perception, et cetera, et cetera. Third, you might clarify that the phrase toggles is a term of art used by some drafters to mean choices that can be made within licenses which people can flip on or off in order to trigger different outcomes.
Yochai, why don't you finish up the presentation properly? I thought it was entirely obvious. What is required are what is acquired upon notification is essentially a promise of a sort not to sue someone who distributes their end products in one of the low and middle income countries as defined by the World Bank. These together, again, Amy mentioned this and I'll stress this, account for 5% of global pharmaceutical revenues. They account for an enormous amount of the disease burden, and the pharmaceutical companies, as they are presented today, essentially, the pharmaceutical companies find themselves today in a political arena that, whether they recognize it or not, is a very uncomfortable one. And there are two main sources of pressure. One, lots of people are dying in Africa every day. Two, lots of people in the US and in other developed nations feel they're being fleeced. These two political movements are putting, are creating pressure to constrain the degree to which the pharmaceutical companies can control the pricing and distribution of their products, the extent to which, in fact, patent protection is expanded and is expanded globally. It would be a good deal for pharmaceutical companies to find a way through which at least one of these would be removed, and would be removed in a way that doesn't expose them to the claim, hey, you're selling it in Africa for $150 and here for $10,000. How come? You can make it for $150. But not if, well, what do you want? You want to go buy this? I'm not doing this. An Indian generic is doing this. I'm not selling there. I'm selling you here what I'm doing. So the only relevant reference is the developed world in which the pharmaceuticals, the brand pharmaceuticals are in fact selling. So this is politically potentially attractive to them, economically not too huge of a burden. I can't remember the rest, but so.
John, I think, had a clarifying question. John Morris from the University of Pennsylvania.
Thanks. Thank you. I have a concern about your model, and it's kind of a, I guess it's conceptually, I just was wondering if you had thought about the alternative model. I mean, you're basically saying give it all away and then take something back. And I'm just wondering why to do that instead of take or give away only that which you, you know, which this licensee needs, which from a contractor perspective is much cleaner, right? You have a very narrow license for this particular use in this particular country. If I was drafting a license, I might actually prefer that model than giving everything away and then having some kind of reversion or something.
The main flow back isn't the university's rights that could be, the critical flow back is not the university's rights. The critical flow back is the extraction of the improvement rights that the licensee will have. So you could structure it as here are only the rights to produce for the US, Europe, Japan. I retain everything else. Doesn't help you in Africa, because what you're doing here is you're saying, here, take worldwide or just US, it doesn't matter, it could be just US. That's still a big enough market for the other person on the other side of the table to say, you want me to pay you X royalties and all of my improvement rights for developing, for selling the products in places that are negligible from my bottom line? Sure, why don't you take it? But the point is, it's not the question of whether we grant the university rights and then require a grant back or reserve them. That's not the critical point. The critical flow back is not something the university can do just by a reservation. The critical flow back is your rights, the things you can patent in South Africa, irrespective of what I do. I want those back purely for purposes of people who are manufacturing and distributing for the developing world. That you can't do with a reservation.
And this is important particularly in two ways. One is if you want to allow production in high-income countries where we know there'll be lots of these kinds of patents. And also, the issue that's come up more and more on a national level is data exclusivity. So regardless, if whoever does the clinical trials will have rights in the data that comes out of it, that's something else that has to flow back just to allow drugs to be registered in the country that you're talking about, generic drugs, for example. And that's become a big issue within free trade agreements. And so those kinds of rights are also really important to this.
So just let me follow up that clarifying question and ask, is it mostly data you're worried about in terms of the quote-unquote improvements that have to flow back? Because I think concrete examples of patents that could be secured by the licensee that would then impede the notifier would be useful, because Yochai said that, you know, usually there are such patents, and I think some concrete examples would be useful for those of us who are thinking about how to use your license. Do you have some concrete examples?
Well, I mean, if you look at most drugs, mm-hmm. There's a whole kind of thicket of patents around them. Mm-hmm. So you can definitely look, you know, and see that this is how things work in, you know, markets like the United States. It increasingly, I think, is also how things are working in other countries. So if you look at, for example, India's just about to start a product patent regime. If you look at their mailbox, where patents have been filed for the last 10 years, there are supposedly around 4,000 pharmaceutical patents in that mailbox. Those are not simple, basic compound patents. I mean, there are a lot of those patents are for dosages and formulations and all of these other kinds of things that will be minor improvement patents. So, I mean, one of the problems with this is it's actually very difficult to get information specifically on kinds of patents in Ghana, because you have to go to the patent office in Ghana to find that out. But what we know is this happens in rich countries. It's certainly going to happen in source countries. It's certainly going to happen in Canada, if it's the Canadian generic you're talking about. So,
good. That's very helpful.
In other words, when you say in source countries, what you mean is India, South Africa, right? So
Canada.
even if you don't have patents in a particular target country, again, given the capacity of production, if you have an independent set of patents on even minor improvements that prevent the total end product from being produced, you can. And if you even only have that in a small number of countries that are the primary places where manufacturing can happen, you can block this from being effective.
Right. And just another concrete example, DDI, which is actually a government-funded, there's no patent on the compound of DDI, one of the AIDS drugs. BMS took out a patent on a particular formulation that included an antacid in Thailand. So this does sort of happen. Mm-hmm. We've seen it
good.
In concrete instances.
Good. Jerry has had his hand up for a while.
Well, One, I have a couple of questions. One just simple observation.
Well, is it a clarifying question, though?
Yeah. Well,
because yeah. We can save a general the discussion.
Well, I think they're clarifying, but you may not. So
okay, so let's can you choose one? You said you had a couple, so if we could choose one.
Well, okay. One is terminology, but I'll leave that. I'll leave the one about what you mean by developing countries. We'll just leave that for a minute.
Low and middle income countries.
As well, defined by the World Bank.
The World Bank, but they have to differentiate between least developing countries and the others, and that legally makes a big difference. Soaring over that.
No. It's not hard. You may disagree with the line, but there's a list. And you can draw the line here and here and here, right?
I'm not making my point, but I'll leave it.
Sorry.
There are two lists.
Well,
that's my point. All right. Okay. So one just question in my mind. It seems to me the model is very ingenious and promising. It seems to me you're assuming, however, as you do it here, I realize this is the simple model. So a certain static view of the generic industry in these countries, whereas a real risk is that they have quite a bit of potential dynamic innovative capacity that's latent, not patent, and so there would be a concern of about their ability to turn around and use this research in other more directly competitive ways with the originating pharmaceutical companies. And I think there are solutions to this problem, and interesting solutions to this problem, but I think they have to be taken into account.
That's great. Did you want to respond, or maybe that we can save the response and the fuller discussion, because I think it's a really important point.
I think that's an important substantive point, I agree.
Yeah, it's a substantive point, right. More than a clarifying point, I think. Anyone else on clarifications? Okay, well, let's move on to Steve Ferguson, who's going to tell us all the wonderful things that NIH has been doing in terms of its licensing practices.
Well, thanks very much. What I thought I'd go through today is give a little background from actually sort of from a practical approach to some of the questions that people here are dealing with in terms of how the NIH intramural program, the licensing program that I work for, has tried to address some of these issues on sort of a case-by-case basis on individual technology, individual situations, and how we've sort of coalesced some of our experiences, both good experiences and bad experiences in terms of particular approaches. So you probably have heard some of these points made in earlier form, either by Mark or others from our office, but I thought it'd be nice for this sort of form, put together in a sort of simple approach and give you an update on where we are on some of these topics. So basically, from a licensor's perspective, whether it's a federal laboratory like ours or an academic university laboratories, these are sort of the things that the licensing officer are dealing with. There's a lot going on. There's a lot of things that are changing. There's a lot of pressures to sort of make things happen. And so these are sort of the things that we're looking at out there in terms of when we're getting ready to do a deal, you know, in terms of the marketplace. You know, it's not just a U.S. sort of focus like traditionally was, at least for the federal labs. The deal is getting very complex because very often they're not just academic pharma, it's academic biotech pharma, multi-stage deals. Regulatory issues, there's PTO issues, the framework keeps changing from time to time. The interesting point is that we're increasingly not dealing just with companies. We're increasingly doing license agreements with NGOs, and we've done a couple examples of that in the type of form that we're talking about here. And also, we're responsible in our institutions for, you know, managing the intellectual property, managing the sort of the research outcomes. So we're looking at sort of the future aspects and making sure that we can get these projects out there and also continue our research, because that's our fundamental goal for all of these sorts of situations. And so I've put together a couple of points here in terms of why public institutions license technology. And there's sort of four main points, but for today's form, I thought I'd focus on the public health and education and well-being aspects, but obviously there's other goals, there's other motivations for institutions in terms of licensing technology, you know, in terms of attracting additional resources through collaborations, return on investment in terms of both public health investment or sometimes even financial issues, and also many universities particularly have charters in terms of economic development. So there's a lot of things going on, though, you know, as in our case, because we are a health institution, as part of the Health and Human Services, we do particularly focus on the public health benefit. And the reason we do here is that similar to some of the other slides you've seen, is that in terms of looking at sort of the disease burden worldwide, and particularly, you know, notice the first point in terms of infectious disease, and that's probably where the major focus of our program has been in these areas, because that's really the major point, major issue to be dealt with in terms of disease categories in underdeveloped countries. So in terms of some general principles that we've sort of worked out in terms of sort of our practical aspects of this are sort of outlined here in terms of, you know, sort of diligence model in terms of requiring a development plan, sort of taking the point earlier made of sort of matching up the license with the actual requirements in terms of its technology, and then therefore granting the appropriate scope of rights. And that translates into sort of field of use and licensed territory issues. And I'll talk a little bit later about sort of a different strategy that we're starting to use in a number of countries in terms of going for a regional approach, where we're actually breaking up an agreement by territory and finding different licensees for different areas. The key element, obviously, for all of this is to have an agreement with enforceable benchmarks so you can monitor the progress of the licensee through development. And that's also correct that that's a burden. That's a resource that a lot of institutions do not have. In our case, we've set up a separate licensing branch in our office that solely handles license monitoring enforcement issues. And it's currently 4 people and could easily use additional folks just because of the growth of the number of agreements that we're doing. And then in the contract negotiation, it's very important then to link whatever public policy issues that you want to happen to benchmarks in the agreement, so it's clear from the start what the expectations are and what sort of the burden that the licensee is looking at. Because the licensee looks at some of these obligations as just another cost of doing business in terms of what's it going to cost them, what's the risk factor, and sort of factor that in with royalties and other performance obligations in the agreement. And then the goal is then to sort of review the licensee's progress, at least on an annual basis, in terms of annual progress reports, looking to see what they may be reporting to SEC or other types of information to sort of keep track of what's going on. And sort of examples of how we've worked with this, so we've termed these sort of white knight clauses, because the very first agreement that we did with these sorts of clauses was actually with a company called White Knight, and so it actually stuck. We thought it was very, very appropriate. sad to say that agreement did not work out. That company did not, that product did not make it to the marketplace. But what it was a special company that made, I think, surgical gloves or gowns that were supposed to be HIV resistant or impermeable to HIV. And we had a provision for them to supply those to at cost to some agencies, at no cost apparently to agencies in Africa as a sort of an interesting approach. Unfortunately, the technology did not pan out and they terminated the license agreement, but though they're gone, their name lives on. And so that sort of fits into the first point in terms of the supply back of products or services. Usually that's supplied back to the agency for clinical trials or for research. That's the most common. Occasionally you might be able to get some donations, but to other areas, but that's a little bit harder to get. Educational programs are always good. Back when websites were novel, this was something that we really pushed. We realized that's not exactly a novel approach anymore. But some of the things that can be very specific in terms of educational aspects, sometimes it's it may sound like advertising, but physician education is actually a very appropriate thing to try in terms of introducing new therapy. In the area of vaccines, education is very critical because of a lot of resistance from kids not wanting shots or parents afraid of particular types of vaccine approaches. So the educational aspect can't really be underestimated. The third point in terms of engine access for licensed products, I'll talk a little about that, and biodiversity and developing country access are sort of the things I'll go into a little more detail. And for engine access programs for licensed products, what we found is that in negotiations, we can usually get this, but usually it's limited to the United States. And that's just because you saw the chart for worldwide burden of disease. Companies really just can't take that on or are unwilling to take that sort of complexity or unknown responsibility. But they do very often have systems set up for providing access to products in the United States, and very often we'll ask that our products participate in those situations, those organizations that they set up. And of course, we don't charge them for the privilege of donating the products. And so the language that we would use in these sorts of contracts is basically to say, after regulatory approval, they'll set up this such a program, or add it to an existing program, since a number of companies do provide this as a service to the pharma industry, so that they can be provided to indigent citizens of the United States who are not covered under any sort of public or private health plan. So as you know, that's a significant gap in the United States currently, as well as at the lack of insurance coverage. And for some of these products, this is an important way to get access to patients for those products. The other thing I'll talk about briefly is the biodiversity issues related to natural products. Amy brought up one particular product in Samoa, and that's actually the compound that's in that, and that is actually one that came from IP developed by the NIH and also I think Brigham Young in terms of that. So it's interesting in terms of how these sorts of things work. I think the main point for this forum is to bring out is that a lot of these, or a number of these sort of natural products, can come from underdeveloped countries because of the biodiversity in those sorts of regions. So these are sort of the important aspects of how to manage that process, because again, it's another way to sort of develop a resource not only for products in Western countries, but also in those markets. And particularly the important aspects here are, of course, are sharing the benefits. And also, it's very difficult sometimes in negotiating contracts, because very often the source country will not have any intellectual property ownership of the discovery, but you want to be able to, but they do own the resource. And so that's sort of a balancing issue in that university or the government agency's licensed intellectual property. And so how do you get some benefit back to the source country when they weren't part of the actual discovery of the product? And we do that most commonly through things of letter of collection, particularly as developed by the National Cancer Institute, as a way to sort of flow back through contractual obligations, benefits to the source country. So we will, as part of this collection, we will also provide sort of training for scientists in the source country, and so that's a way to also help build up infrastructure capacity and R&D capabilities in the source country through scientific exchanges and training. And so we negotiate then with licensees for these rights to develop the intellectual property that's discovered, to make sure that there is some flowback for the country. And if it's something that's going to be, rather than recombinant produced, if it's actually going to be sourced from agricultural growing situation, we ask that the source country be the preferred source for the bulk material. So in terms of that, what we do is that we, in our license agreement, we require the developer to provide back sign a contract or agreement with the source country, whoever the responsible agency is in the source country, for a contract to supply some sort of financial return or development issues with them. We leave the actual contract terms open, though we do provide an offset for the financial obligations to us for that. In terms of developing country access, in terms of what we're looking here is to say that when we grant a worldwide license agreement, we actually try to make sure that we do cover the other countries outside of Europe or the U.S. for which these products may have a market. And we ask that the licensee provide plans. It's usually a plan that would be submitted after a product approval in the EU or the U.S. for how they're going to do the non-U.S. markets, either by direct sales or joint venture or sub-licensing. And we have an updated commercial development plan, and again, this will be usually after first commercial sale, after product has actually been tested and approved and see that it actually works well in humans. And so what we typically have in terms of contract language is sort of a period of 6 months after such an approval where they will detail their plan for public sector marketplaces in these developing countries. And for developing countries, we've used the Gavi list. And basically, then this will be an amendment to their license agreement to show their performance in this sort of area. And so what they will do is that we leave it open as to how they approach it, whether it's from a direct sales approach, through a partnership, or through a sub-license. And we're open to either sort of progress in this sort of area. And in doing this, we have this in a number of agreements. It's too early to tell how this is going to work in practice, but we're hopeful that the issue is that if it's the developed timelines for these products usually are 6 to 8 or 9 or 10 or longer years in Western countries, so it's going to take a while to see how this works out in terms of these other markets. So in terms of regional license strategies, that's the other approach that we've been looking at. And here we're taking advantage of the growth of pharma and biotech outside of the traditional Western markets and manufacturers in the U.S., Europe, Canada, and Australia, and Japan. We know we've done well, we think, in those markets in terms of knowing who these people are, finding the right licensees, and putting things into practice. Outside these markets has been sort of a challenge, and through that, to help us, we've added a specialist in our office just to work on these international markets to make the contacts for our licensing group to work deals with. And so what we found so far is that there is interest outside of these markets now as companies emerge. And certain technologies, in our experience, particularly vaccines, are particularly good matches for firms in these areas. And that's because a lot of these firms have been working on vaccines, because vaccines are probably the things that give you the most bang for the buck in terms of public health impact in these markets. And we saw before that the major issue was, of course, infectious disease in terms of the worldwide disease burden. So far, we've been able to work with our regional firms or regional institutions in India, China, and Brazil, and put together, in certain cases, separate agreements and for the Western markets. So in terms of where we are today, these are some of the examples of some of the places we've been working with, showing some agreements that we've completed and some that are still in progress. In terms of, again, conjugated meningitis vaccine, again, working with PATH. It was being manufactured by the Serum Institute in India for distribution in a number of markets. We've also been working with a different version of human rotavirus vaccine than what was originally approved in the U.S. And this is actually a human bovine reassortment. And with that, we have closed a deal with Bhutan Tan for Brazil, and we're working with a number of institutions. In the U.S., and Western markets will have a single licensee. India and China will have multiple licensees for this product. We're hopeful anyway, in late stages of negotiation. Actually, the slides, I just submitted this a week ago, but it's already out of date. The IVI deal has closed, and so we're pleased to say that the typhoid feature conjugated vaccine will be licensed to IVI, has been licensed to IVI for distribution primarily in their markets they're looking at in terms of Southeast Asia. We're also looking at a project on dengue, where we have one licensee already biologically in India, and we're hoping to close a deal with a very famous Brazil institution very, very soon. So in terms of issues that come up in terms of negotiation from a corporate, in dealing with corporations with by university academics, these are sort of the issues that come up at, you know, with the stage of this technology. And I think that's a factor that hasn't really been talked about already, is that most of the universities' technology is a very early stage and don't really work necessarily well, or if at all, and have unproven IP rights. I think that affects the negotiation. But that's certainly part of our negotiation with companies to recognize that. And it requires a number of other things here in terms of cooperation of the scientists, commitment of the parties. All these are the factors that go into it. And of course, the financial issues come up as well. But I think the important point that universities and federal labs are now realizing that because we're public institutions, it's not just about the money. There's a lot of other factors going into, and that's why we're here today to talk about this further. So thanks.
Thank you, Steve. It looks like we have at least one clarifying question from Jerry.
I think it's very promising. I just want to get a clear idea of the jurisdiction, product jurisdiction. These are all NIH-funded products to begin with. There's Bayh-Dole questions, not Bayh-Dole questions.
No, these are all projects or materials that the NIH owns itself.
These intramural. Are
intramural inventions.
Intramural. Okay, thank you very much.
Can I ask one clarifying question? In terms of your development plan requirement, I didn't quite get, maybe it was in the second slide where you talked about how when you're enforcing this, this is not just a reporting requirement. There's some notion that if you're not satisfied with their development plan, you'll do X.
Right. Well, yes, it's part of the requirements of their agreement for the Western markets. Right. They usually are able to give us a plan for rolling a product out in Europe or the U.S. And that's the basis of that grant of a license. But they're usually, the companies usually don't have a very clear idea of what would happen after that. I mean, because they're looking probably 6 to 8 or 10 more years in the future. And so what we said, we'll accept that you don't know. We'll accept you don't know the conditions of how you're going to do this, but at the time that you do have success, that we know that the product actually works because it gets approval by the FDA or in Europe, then give us a plan for how you're going to distribute, how you're going to sublicense, how you're going to partner the technology that now you know works in those markets. So it's requiring, in essence, sort of a similar plan that what we got from them when we agreed to grant the license in the first place. So if they say that they don't want to do it, then we get we can renegotiate the agreement. I doubt we would actually terminate the agreement because we'd have a product already on sale in the U.S. But we have those rights available for ex-U.S. or non-U.S. sales, perhaps. The other thing we have done sometimes.
Would that be with their improvements? So if they have
no,
it's just your technology.
Right. The improvements I think are a lot more than people realize because usually the institution has made just the fundamental observation. The improvements are probably tenfold, or that there's a number of things in terms of know-how, materials. You mentioned regulatory filings. There's a whole bundle of other things that's probably a truckload with a paper that are not part of the initial discovery.
Any other clarifying questions? Okay, our last speaker will be Katherine Wu, who has already been introduced, but she's going to be speaking about some very interesting agreements that One World Health has struck with particularly the University of California, Berkeley, on in inter alia artemisinin, which is a very important therapy for malaria.
Thank you, Arti, and I want to thank the organizers again for inviting our company to participate, which gives me a really good opportunity to introduce our company to all of you and also to share some of the experiences that we have from the trenches, so to speak, and also from the perspective of a licensee. And I'm looking forward to learning from most of you, all of you, about some of these larger issues, which we often don't have time to think about, but it's really good opportunity for me to get up to the 30,000 feet and consider some of these issues. Our company is the Institute for One World Health. We're based in San Francisco. Let's see, this is mouse.
Oh, did you need the, yeah, it should advance. It should advance.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, there you go.
Great. And our mission is to develop safe, effective, and affordable new medicine for diseases in the developing world. And we want to emphasize new because we are not a generic maker. We develop treatment for diseases that don't already have treatment. Oops. Or we find new uses for existing drugs for to treat diseases in developing world. As the previous speaker have mentioned, there's a 1090 gap in the research and the disease burden in this world. And one of the point that I want to make here is that most of the death that happens are happening in children. And a lot of the times it's not only about the lack of medicine to treat them. For example, measles, they're, is there a pointer? There's a pointer. Right, measles. Mm-hmm. There's very effective vaccines against measles, but there is a public health, general public health failure in the countries that are, in developing countries that sort of creating a situation where these medicine are not getting to the people. So there's really a variety of different intervention point that we can think about trying to help. So One World Health was founded in 2000 by Victoria Hale. Her background has been in FDA and also in the biotech pharmaceutical industry. We're founded in 2000 and we attained 501c3 nonprofit status in 2001. And it was actually a very interesting strategic point at that time in that by forming a corporation and then attaining the nonprofit status, we are able to take the profit incentive out of the drug development process, but still retain some of the efficiency and take advantage of pharmaceutical science to advance global health. So Victoria was a pharmaceutical scientist, and she created this social entrepreneurship enterprise to work with really everyone involved. Go back. We work with academia and industry to assemble drug leads. We work with a lot of community scientists, both in academia as well as in company, who often step forward to donate their expertise and time and energy to help us get products evaluated and developed. We leverage government grants, and most importantly, we leverage philanthropic investment in the development of these new therapies. Our core expertise is in product development. As you know, in the drug development process, there are a number of inputs. There's the discovery area, which is the forte of academia research. There's also, on the other end, manufacturing distribution, which is the forte of a number of NGOs on the ground. And what we're hoping to fill the gap is in product development. And our day-to-day work really is involved. It includes optimizing leads. We perform preclinical toxicology study. We sponsor clinical trial research. And also our expertise is really in regulatory approval of worldwide, to enable worldwide distribution of the therapy that we make. This is just a snapshot of our pipeline. We have a lead product, which is poromycin. It's a off-patent aminoglycoside, which we are using to treat visual leishmaniasis. We just completed a phase 3 clinical trial in Bihar, India, and we are filing for regulatory approval in a few months, and we're anticipating approval by the end of the year and distribution sometime next year. We have a number of early stage programs, and I'm going to talk to you about specifically about two. One is on Chagas disease, and then one, as already mentioned, is in malaria. Just to kind of summarize a number of things, or actually preview a number of points that we're trying to make, is that we, as a company, we try to employ two strategies to enable us to have access to technology. The 501c3 status that we have enable us to receive donation of patents, both from university as well as from companies. And an example here is from Celera Genomics. which donated a lead compound for Chagas disease to us in 2001. We also received a patent donation from the University of California on a new method to treat schistosomiasis using an off-patent class of drugs. Now, the focus of what the remaining of the talk is going to be on some of the creative way that we've come up with licensing agreements that allow us to do our job in the context of intellectual property law. I'm going to briefly touch on the first example and spend a bit more time on the second. Just a few words about the disease. Chagas disease is American trypanosomiasis. It's caused by a parasite called Tryposoma cruzi, and is the disease of the Americas. It's mostly only in the Americas. That's very is a little bit in Africa, but mostly in South America, Mexico. Currently, 10 to 12 million people are estimated to be infected, with 50,000 deaths per year. It's a leading cause of heart failure in Latin America. This disease is a curious creature in the sense that there are two phases. There's an acute phase, which is when you've got bitten by a sandfly, which is the carrier of the parasite. In some of the time, you experience fever and malaise, and then your symptoms go away. And what it's going to get you is that 10 to 15 years later, the parasite take up residence in your internal tissue, mostly in the heart, and you would get congenital heart failure. It's also been, there has been confirmed cases in the US. I think in 2001, there was, I think, a number of New York Times articles detailing some cases that came from transplantation of organs from immigrants. Also, it's been found in insects and mammals. So it's, even though it's primarily a neglected disease in the developing world, it's actually, you know, keeping appearing in developed country also. Now, the agreement that we've done with University of Washington and Yale involve a class of azole compound, which are in the very early stage of development. It's been shown in vitro that it has really strong anti-T cruzi activity as well as other activities against other diseases. So the license that we were able to negotiate was kind of touch on some of the issue that was mentioned earlier, is that we have a territory split in the sense that we have all developing countries, and it wasn't really a particular list per se, but we actually list out all the countries, and it was negotiated. And the key point here is royalty free. Oops. It's very challenging.
Yeah, you have to be careful. It's very delicate.
Yeah. And we also, at the same time, have an integration split in that the two universities believe that there's actually market for the other compounds in the group in antifungal field. So we are able to get the antiparasitic field, which encompasses Chagas disease as well as others. And the university retained the rights to other fields so that they can license it to other groups. So in this particular license, we each get what we needed. We have the, OneWorld Health has the freedom to select the compound for development. It's a very early stage, so we don't know which it is, but we have the rights to the class. And we also have the right to modify compounds. And the university retained the ability to get royalty out of this particular innovation also. So I think at the time when it was signed, it was one of the earliest example of a licensing from university to a nonprofit group that is in this structure. But since then, there are a number of other agreement that was struck in similar ways. So the second example I'm going to give you is one about malaria. Many of you are familiar with the toll of malaria, and the current gold standard treatment for malaria is artemisinin combination therapy, which is recommended by WHO and also a recently published report by the Institute of Medicine to be the therapy of choice because it's one of the drugs that seems to not cause resistance in people. And when you use in combination, you can actually extend the life of the usefulness of artemisinin. Now, because it's been recommended by WHO, well, let me backtrack. WHO negotiated prices or a certain agreement with pharmaceutical company to supply combination therapy at a cost. Coartem is just one such therapy. It's a combination of artemisinin and lufafeltrin. And it's Novartis agreed to sell to WHO at cost. Now, even though at this low price, lots of people in Africa in particular cannot afford this treatment. And despite that, because it's been recommended by the WHO, there's a worldwide shortage of artemisinin. Artemisinin comes from wormwood plant and is extracted in a using an organic process that usually yield not very much from each plant. And there's, of course, the growth season, et cetera. So there's a shortage, and I think there was an article about 2 weeks, 2 months ago in The Economist saying that even if there's a market there, there's really not enough artemisinin to go around. I think Novartis is only able to buy about half of what they need to produce what WHO have ordered. So this is a problem then, not because there's no treatment, but because of the scarcity of the ingredient of the treatment, it become a problem. So what we have done is to form a partnership with two groups, a university group, UC Berkeley, and a small biotech company called Amaris Biotechnology. And this grant was funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and it was announced in December. And what we're planning to do is to create a way to make artemisinin from E. coli. And it's through the biosynthetic technique that's invented in the Keesling Laboratory. What they've done is to take the biosynthetic pathway of plant and transplant it in E. coli, so that you can actually use fermentation processes to create a scalable supply of artemisinin derivatives. Amaris Biotechnology is going to be involved in scaling up the whole process and also optimizing the production process from lab scale to production scale. And what OneWorld Health is doing is we are kind of managing the entire project as well as providing regulatory guidance and be the key interface with regulatory agencies, as well as work with NGOs and downstream manufacturer to ensure that the product that we make, which is a microbially sourced compound as opposed to a plant-derived compound, will be accepted by global groups and be used everywhere. So as I mentioned, what we're trying to do is to create a biotech way of producing a plant-derived material so that we can scale it when the need goes up, and also in the process reduce costs and reduce impurity, because we can now use standard chemical and purification technique and not have to extract it with organics. This is a 5-year grant. A lot of reporters have mentioned that, you know, it's a huge amount of money, but it's actually a 5-year grant and it's divided up with different groups, so we're not the ones that get all the money. I just want to say that. So the technology involved, as I mentioned, is the bioengineered strain, as well as know-how as to how to grow these bugs. I mean, this is a very, very much an art as well as science. And it's a very early technology. Actually, we have about 4/5 of the genes needed in the bug right now, but there's still a couple of genes that could optimize the whole process. So you can imagine anticipated improvement downstream would include, you know, better strains with more genes in there, new processes to make them grow better, and also the scale-up technology, which are mostly know-how, but there might be new technology that will result from this process, in the process of making artemisinin. So what we are able to achieve in this agreement is we received, first of all, a royalty-free license to core technology. The core technology can be used towards artemisinin production as well as producing a number of other organic compounds such as fragrances. It can produce a whole family of terpenoids. So we get royalty-free for malaria and in developing countries. And this one, I think, matched pretty well with the low middle-income list. And this is the part that I think was really novel in the sense that we're able to engage University of California to give us an upfront license to all future improvement to be applied in developing world and in malaria. As many of you know, usually university don't give you upfront license for future. You usually get a right to first refusal, for example, if you sponsor the research. But we were able to negotiate with university to who see that, you know, we're to kind of make this as an example and hope that other university will follow. And also, you know, in the contract, we agree as a really a three-way partnership between the partners, and we're gonna, if there are any other negotiation coming up in the future to perhaps we need another piece of enabling technology to go forward, we decided to collaborate together to take it, and OneWorld Health would take the lead to get the piece for the developing world. So again, the bottom line of this really complex agreement, actually there are three in a bundle, is that we get the freedom to transfer the technology to the developing world once the process is perfected, and so that we can distribute it manufacturing in the appropriate to get it to the appropriate people. So this is just summarizing some of the principle that we use, because we are we work with everybody. Global health is a really big problem, and we think that the more partners we engage from all sides of the equation, the better we are. We focus on development, and we want, in particular, to be the bridge between academic public sector and the private sector. And we try to not to be duplicative, and we facilitate translation of academic research. And because of these qualities, we are hoping to engage more public sectors partners, because we really have common goals. We all want to create products for public good, and we have complementary expertise. Academic institutions are really great at art, and we are good at D, so it's really a natural partner. And one element that we haven't mentioned is really the motivation of individual scientists can really do a lot. For all of these partnerships, we work not just with the University of Tech Transfer Office, but really the principal investigator and inventor of technology was a champion to, you know, getting us the license. So that's, we think, is very important. And we also try to engage or, you know, creating more ways, creating a new path, if you will, to work with private sector and really to re-engage them back into global health diseases, appealing to perhaps their sense of corporate responsibility. And also some of the benefits that they would get from working with us is really public, positive publicity, which, you know, actually academic institutions also enjoy that as well. And we hope that we're able to engage more of these groups who work together, because these are really our stakeholders. We don't answer to stockholders, we're a nonprofit, but, you know, these are people that, you know, ultimately we're looking to help and be responsible to. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Okay, any clarifying questions for Katherine? Yes, David.
I just have a general question, and this actually is a clarifying one for you because you specifically brought it up, but it was implicit in the earlier conversations. To make a lot of these things work, you actually start with a platform, and then you have to do improvements and modifications and customizations and everything else thereupon. And I'm struck with the inherent dissonance that has with actually the core of IP policy, which presumes that innovation futures is somehow a property right. That somehow by participating in this organization, you are ensured that the next person who improves a better mode of delivery or a better manufacturing process is actually a participating and a willing accomplice in your paradigm. And I find that to be a disingenuous assumption, because the fact of the matter is future IP isn't IP. You can't, you know, University of California can say they're going to give you all the future rights, but if University of California doesn't do it, that's a meaningless component of the process. So I'm wondering how you actually contemplate a world in which you advance to a certain stage, a certain methodology, a certain mode of production, and then a non-accomplice decides to look at this and go, well, we're going to run with it. Thank you very much for advancing it to the 80-yard line. we're going to go ahead and finish out the 20-yard line, and we're not going to pay any attention to the agreements that you have. There's nothing intrinsic in IP law that assures you any of that future right, and I'm intrigued by how we're assuming that somehow or another the known parties are all accomplices, and that assumption doesn't hold in any context, and certainly not here. I'm wondering how that's handled in your context.
That's an interesting question, because we are also thinking about that, but I think we're coming from perhaps a naive position, but maybe that's the advantage, because if we had contemplated all these complexities, we wouldn't go ahead with the deal, right? In fact, with other, I think in our paradigm, our goal is really to drive down the prices of an API, active pharmaceutical ingredient. So in the scenario that you describe with other participants coming into the market, it's actually good for us. The more competition we have, the better. We drive down the prices more, and that achieves our goal. And it's, I appreciate the tension that you mentioned, because you know we are using intellectual property not to create barriers for other people to entry, but to ensure that products are made. So, you know, in some sense, I mean, you're right that you know other participants who are not part of this deal would make improvement, and they would not be part of this whole arrangement. But you know, you see license to us, you know, what they can control, which is, you know, directly resulting from this work. So I'm not sure.
Can I clarify your clarifying question just a little bit?
Because there's a very important semantic statement that was just made. Okay. Directly resulting from. Okay? You just stated the words directly resulting from. Directly resulting from is not owned by anybody yet. Okay? Directly resulting.
Why is that? I mean,
because
what are you talking about? Are you suggesting there is no such, there is no control that a current patent fee has on improvements?
Absolutely, because if a new entrant patents a novel extension, that new entrant is entitled to whatever limitation and right they exact in a marketplace.
But are you a lawyer?
I'm sorry?
Are you a lawyer?
That's not germane.
No, it is germane, because
yes, it is.
Because if you, I'm sorry to interrupt, but really, this is a very important point.
You may have a patent
on the improvement. Excuse me, but the underlying patent, if it's broad enough, will certainly control that improvement patent.
Except for the fact that the exclusionary right and the patentably distinct right is actually something that no one, until it is granted, has to own, grant, or transfer.
Perhaps we should leave this particular point and take it offline, because I think this is an important point of patent law that really should not be confused. So perhaps you and I can take this offline.
But patent law does not grant an affirmative improvement right to anyone.
Yes, it does.
No.
Absolutely. Are you a lawyer?
Any new entrant into the market.
David, we're really going to have to take this offline, because it absolutely does. Okay? All right. Dan.
I have a clarification. Do the licenses give you the right to manufacture and do other development-related activities within the United States, or only within the developing country, or?
Both in the U.S. and in developing world.
Okay, so you have the right to do everything in the United States except sell.
Right.
And you have the right to sell and do everything else in any other country.
Correct.
Can I ask, just following up on that, do you have any licenses where you have a right to sell in the United States, even for these very neglected diseases or traveler's markets?
No, we don't do that. And that's one of the way we can engage for profit to it, because you know, we get the developing world rights, they get the developed world right, and they can recoup some of the investment, but they will join with us to get the profit.
But none of the universities, for example, have been willing to give you the market in the United States, even for something like Chagas.
We haven't asked for it. In fact, Yale have actually come back to us, because they reserved that other half of the patent, and it's been 3 years now, they have not been able to find a for-profit licensee, so they actually come to us to see if we want the rest of it, and we're kind of currently in negotiation.
Okay, lots of clarifying questions, my goodness. Sandy has had her hand up for a while.
Very quick clarifying question. I presume that artemisinin works for both Plasmodium vivax and falciparum. Is that right?
I think falciparum mostly, but maybe vivax too. I'm not certain.
Bob, I think you had your hand up for a while.
Oh, I was just going to say that we're in the process of negotiating a license with the university that grants an exclusive right to both commercial and non-commercial markets, with the right to sublicense in the commercial markets, leaving the university as a partner in that sublicense, and a will receive a percentage of that sublicense revenue. So that can work.
Very interesting. And Greg, this is the last question, and then we'll move on to general discussion.
Katherine, are these license grants exclusive within these particular fields of use, or might these universities grant similar licenses to others?
I think for malaria is exclusive. They can certainly grant it for other indications.
And is that important to your organization, that it be exclusive?
Yes and no. I mean, yes in the sense that we do want to make this a sustainable enterprise down the road. So, you know, even though we're not for profit, we do want to generate some revenue that so that hopefully from the sale of the middle income countries, we can support or, you know, the lowest income sector in the same country as well as others. So, yeah, it was important, and the university was not opposed to giving that to us. In fact, the company sublicensed a piece of the technology to us also exclusively for malaria.
And just following up on that, now, do you know what rights they hold in, say, for example, low and middle income countries? So when it's exclusive, obviously that only is relevant if there are exclusive rights held by the licensor.
Right. I mean, these patents are still in application stage, so none of them have been granted. But, you know, the plan is certainly to have worldwide coverage.
Okay.
Or whatever is appropriate.
Anthony, clarifying question?
Yes, just building on this, does that mean from the rents that you might receive from middle-income country sales of the product, this would go towards cross-subsidizing only the price in least developed countries, or do you also anticipate that would support operating costs or future R&D investments by the Institute for One World Health?
That's a possibility. We're actually in the process of generating models to see what it looks like. But again, I mean, the goal of this project really is twofold. We want to alleviate the supply shortage and also drive the price down. And it's unclear which goal we'll reach first, but hopefully we'll get both. So yeah, we don't know what revenue stream we're really expecting, but.
I have a question. So the universities filed for patent protection and in those markets for these indications? You know, the markets, there's actually IP in those underdeveloped countries for this indication?
Well, it's really a core technology. I mean, they patented the strain or actually using a microbially constructed synthetic biology strain.
It's really a core technology.
It's
really a material.
Exactly.
The IP is probably not really that critical.
Right. Well, I mean, the company, which is a partner of us, is very interested, motivated to actually enable, you know, like they want to have more IP rights around the technology.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, they would be motivated to actually protect that. But, you know, we have the feel for malaria.
Yeah. Well, that's actually an important point, because a lot of times the driver is actually the physical construct that the university has made, and the IP is just...
And the know-how of the inventor, right. I think. I mean, we license both the IP as well as the know-how. So,
right.
Yeah, no, Steve's point is an excellent general one, that tangible property rights often matter at least as much, if not more, than the intellectual property right. So, Dan, did you have something you wanted to add?
I was just going to take an unjustified jab at the pharmaceutical industry.
Oh, no, not allowed. Not allowed. This is a collegial event. and some of our best friends have affiliations with the pharmaceutical industry.
You mentioned how large your grant was, and I was like, I don't think it's $400 million. And if we know the pharmaceutical industry says it costs $800 million to research and develop a drug.
Okay, Dan, that's an unjustified jab for the moment. Okay, so yeah, and opportunity cost as well. So, okay, so let's throw it up to general discussion and throw it open, I should say, to general discussion. And first of all, I want to thank, before we open it up, let me step back. I want to thank our speakers for very engaging and interesting presentations. And I have a whole bunch of questions that I myself want to ask, but I will hold off and abstain so that you guys can get into the mix. Usha.
Arti, I'm going to come back to whoever Bob is.
Oh, Bob. You know Bob.
Not Bob, this Bob.
Oh, this Bob, yeah. Oh, the other Bob.
The mentioning of the sub-license portion of it. So for example, I mean, as much as the improvements assessment was going on, clearly as a negotiator from the university side, it's going to be extremely hard to get improvements back into any part from anybody that you license to. I mean, even if I went to Institute for One World Health and asked them to license back their improvements, what would you say?
It's baked into it.
It's going to be hard. Bringing it up.
Well, although it sounds like, Katherine, you're saying it's not so hard.
No, I mean, like, we...
So this is a fundamental dispute.
Well, I think if you get down to the construction of a license, it's just going to be... I mean, I'm just saying it would take a lot of time, even if it's...
I think it'd take motivating parties to do that.
Pardon me?
I think it'd take, you know, parties who really want the project to happen to make it...
Okay.
Obviously, we have an existence proof where UC Berkeley was willing to give you improvements.
No, so. But I'm coming back to the point of improvements that could be actually shifted over for generate manufacture wherever, right? You know, that was Yohai's point. Not just for the project, but really to be available more broadly beyond a particular project, right? Am I understanding that right?
There's a little bit of clarification, I think, that needs to happen, partly going back to 5 minutes later, understanding Jerry's point about developing countries, partly pointing out to Jamie's points about toggles, and then partly coming back. This is a general architecture of an agreement, right? There are lots of things, and that's why when I was talking about the research, I exposed the various toggles, as we call them, the various degrees of freedom in designing an institutional framework. The particular image that I put up there on the back was a particular arrangement that lines up all of these various components in a particular way, in terms of what it is that you're actually trying to achieve for what and what degree of expansion over the world. When we're actually going to go into implementing this, what we're probably going to have to need is a suite of standard licenses rather than one standard license applied to particular conditions and particular instances. And this might include, what is the region you're talking about? How do you define developing worlds? This might include, what do you mean by improvements and how far you include by improvements? So that's at a broad level. This image is an architecture intended to identify a number of core components. One, you negotiate as a contract, as opposed to you make the difference in policy. Two, it's okay from all legal formal perspectives to ask for something that includes somebody else's rights. This we've learned from open source licensing. And three, universities, if they adopt a standard practice, can actually control a large amount of necessary patents that would make it very difficult to simply ignore these requirements. Which brings us back more specifically to your question of, or your claim that improvements are hard, and this disagreement of, when you say improvements are hard, you could be meaning it's hard to negotiate them because we don't have enough leverage. Well, that depends already on the degree to which the practice is standard, is understood by universities to be oppositions that universities take as a matter of administrative policy decided at multi-institutional presidential level, and they say, this is what we do. And this is what we do, and we do it for the public good, and you can't have this unless you sign on. There could be another question of difficult, which is difficult to draft and define precisely what it is that you're doing. That actually is not that hard, right? And let me define what I mean by not that hard. Not that hard, not in the sense that it doesn't require a lot of work to sit down and hammer very, very carefully what you mean and how. Not that hard in the sense that we have the models, we have the way to start working on it. We've seen one license here, we've seen another license there. There may be limitations. Worf has some mechanism. There are materials. It's not new science. It's just hammering out the engineering of a particular set of agreements. And however hard it is, if we're talking about the creation of a standard practice across universities, it's fairly simple to find a set of people who will be willing to sit, do this, develop it. And in fact, we're working on this now. Test it with technology transfer officers. Test it with the generics industry and what the level of risk is that they're willing to live. Test it with pharma and see to what extent this will lead to nuclear war or what can be done. And develop a set of standard practices that we can all decide, this is what we're going to do. So those are two very different meanings of improving this.
I was actually referring to the second one, which if you say it's solvable at least, it's encouraging. I'd like to see whether Amy recalls from the meeting that we had at the AAAS-CP committee in December, when it came up in the context of transactions costs. And if you can comment on it, just in terms of the standardization of humanitarian licensing provisions, the reservation versus what I would consider as the additional provision for improvements to come back into licensing.
Well, I think the transaction costs will be reduced, generally speaking, by some form of standardization, and that's our hope anyway. So then, whether or not. Obviously, the more ambitious the standardized license, the more it asks universities to do and extract out of their licensees. We're resting pretty heavily on the fact that, this is 5% of the market, and that universities have done things in the past, like said, we will not accept certain restrictions on publication rights, for example, because that's part of our institutional mission, and this is our policy. And so we're relying on this sort of dynamic to say, let's figure out what would be best for patients in developing countries and presume that's part of the university's mission. So, and then the transaction costs, again, particularly given the vast scope between what tech transfer offices really have the time and the resources to do, minimizing that by creating standard licenses that also will be somewhat binding on the university so that you can go and say, I don't have an option about this. I have to do this. That will decrease your transaction costs in that sense too.
Let's see, Mark.
I like the idea that you were discussing in terms of the model. My concern is similar in that if we're talking about a product that the development of a product for Western markets where there is a market and a profit to be made, we all join together and agree on commonality. I think we might have some leverage. But when we can't get companies interested in products for third world diseases, developing world diseases, even with exclusive rights and all the traditional ways and motivations, I guess I'm wondering what motivation is there for entry into this market by exacting more costs back from the developing institution or company.
This is something I think Yochai mentioned, that this is not a solution for areas where there are no interested licensees because there's just no money in it. In that sense, I think you have to go the One World Health route. And then also acknowledge that exclusivity isn't helping you there, so don't use it, right? Or use it in a sense that you give it to One World Health knowing that that's, they're going to use it to cross-subsidize or, So in that sense, I think that the model is, there's very little evidence that that model works. If you have a developing country-specific disease, yeah, you can't leverage anything because you can't get private companies to do an agreement. So this is not gonna work for that. This is to leverage where you do have some agreement and some willingness to agree. Siphon off the part that can be shared. And in the other cases, I think it's these kind of innovative, also not just nonprofits but developing country licensees that will really make more of a difference. Obviously.
Bob Cook Deegan.
Actually, Mark, pretty much, I'll finish the, it's just a tiny add-on to what, Yochai and Amy, it sounds like your model is basically you're specifying, what you've done is you specified a bunch of things that should be on the table at the front end that you can go through the list, right? And I think I also hear you saying what we should do is we should start with a fairly high norm of asking for everything. So all the toggles are on for the university, and you as kind of, I guess, implicitly assume that all the toggles are off when the company comes to the table to decide. And everybody's flying into this incredibly dense fog of uncertainty, and you hope there isn't a collision. But anyway, I'm interested in the process by which you would transfer this model into situations. You are begging somebody to come use your technology. You're not in the power position, and yet a lot of the assumptions embedded here are, gosh, I've got all the power, and you've got to play by my rules. That might work if there were a system-wide norm that said that. So I think I hear you saying that, but how do you get there to those norms?
That's actually an incredibly important question. And it starts out with the image that you have, which is that all we're doing is specifying a set of toggles and a fog. And I want to make sure that I've now, being overly concerned that we are selling one narrow license, I have broken too hard in the opposite direction. When I say that these are toggles, what I mean to say is that there is a cluster, there's a solution space with a cluster of components that can be worked. Not that then on a case-by-case deal, you set up a completely open menu of choose whatever you want, because my sense from having had conversations and our sense from having done the research is that in that situation, most of the toggles, most of the time, would be in the direction of no access. And so the critical point is actually to get a university-wide agreement on a fairly narrow, though not one, but a fairly narrow set of rules. This has been an argument within the open source development and the free software community now for 6, 7, 8 years. About whether on one hand there should be one license, one approach, the GPL with copyleft maybe a little bit, or a much wider range of approaches. If you look at the Creative Commons, which is an attempt to port this approach to cultural and informational materials, there the approach has been, here's a large suite of things, and flip the toggles as you want, you can do it by yourself. In software, it's numerically, something on the order of 85% of projects ended up choosing the one fairly strict norm, because that turns out to protect these projects from appropriation by people who just take pieces and go away much better, and that turned out to be more important. Back to this question here, I suspect we will, not I suspect, let's talk about process as opposed to about outcome. we've already started, and it's not really advanced enough to come and talk in full detail about who and how and what the details are, starting to work with technology transfer officers, starting to work and talk with generics manufacturers. It'll take a while, but then we'll have to talk with pharmaceuticals to try to see, given the design freedom we have, given the degrees of freedom that are available to us to define a narrow set of standard practices. And these will be different when you're talking about something that you've got this thing, you know it will have some set of applications in Africa or in South America, and we know this up front. So let's negotiate it, so let's not so much negotiate it as say, this falls under this standard practice that the AUP has stamped its approval on as this is what we're doing as the university system in the United States. When you're in a situation where you don't know really, but you want to keep, there'll be some very minimal good faith type, we know of the standard practice, we understand it, if something comes along, we'll talk within that space. Somewhere in between those, we may well need an intermediate arrangement. But there will be two or three options with publicly accessible documents documenting these, both in terms of the what the Creative Commons calls lawyer-readable language, that is to say an actual license that you can just say, here, plug this in. Whatever else you do, plug this in. And more importantly, in the sense of a clear sense of what the transaction flow will look like so that people understand it. And then you need to go through a political process within the universities to actually make this not something that here there's somebody who's particularly attracted to it and they're trying to do this and they're arm wrestling with this particular company that's more attentive to its political pressures. There's somebody with a little less emphasis and a pharmaceutical company that thinks we're never going to give up on anything. And we'll just have it. It's got to start by understanding the basic architecture, by a process on the technical, knowledgeable level of designing someone something that can work and we can live with, and then a public political movement to make this a general commitment of universities. This is what we do. Here's the range of things we do, and here's the set of materials we use to use them. This is the standard practice. Now go do it.
Okay, we have a lot of hands still up. However, I think that we are now running about 25 minutes behind, and therefore we should probably conclude our questions for the moment. We will have, as many of you know, an opportunity to further pursue these discussions this afternoon. So let's go ahead and take, say, a 10-minute break, and then we'll reconvene for the pooling discussion at 11:05. We started a little bit late, so I don't feel too bad. We've actually started quite a bit late, so I don't feel too bad. But let's reconvene in 10 minutes, and with Anthony So leading off our pooling discussion.
Yeah, right.